Great. So I'm really excited to have the opportunity to talk to you a little bit about some work we've been doing in Baltimore. And before I start, I just want to take a moment to acknowledge my co-authors who are listed here, as well as our funding source for this work, which was the National Science Foundation. Yes, there we go. Okay. So I probably don't need to tell you, and I won't belabor the fact that pharmaceuticals are detected like fairly ubiquitously in freshwater systems. We see them in urban areas and places dominated and influenced by humans, but we also find them in places as remote and far-flung as national parks and Antarctica. And even at the low concentrations that we find them in the environment, they can disrupt physiological and ecological processes. And effluent, treated effluent from wastewater treatment plants is well-known and indeed one of the best known sources of pharmaceutical pollution to the environment. But here we wanted to ask about the pharmaceutical loads in an urban stream that doesn't receive treated effluent. And also we wanted to take those loads and try to partition them among the major sources that are contributing pharmaceuticals in this urban stream. So to do, okay, sorry, I'm still getting used to it. To do this, we used weekly water samples from a watershed in Baltimore, Maryland, that does not receive any wastewater treatment plant effluent. So all of the sewage produced by the approximately 350,000 residents of this watershed is piped across the watershed boundary into an adjacent watershed for treatment. And for each of these samples, we measured the concentration of 92 pharmaceuticals. And we also combined this with USGS streamflow data, which is at the resolution of every 5 minutes. And so our data set does include samples from about 7 sites distributed through the watershed here, but for the purposes of today's talk, I'll just talk about the watershed outlet, which you can see indicated here in the bottom right, and which empties into the Baltimore's Inner Harbor and ultimately the Chesapeake Bay. So for these weekly water samples collected from November 2017 to 2018, we ultimately detected 16 different pharmaceuticals from 9 different therapeutic classes. The most commonly detected pharmaceutical was trimethoprim, which is an antibiotic, and we detected that in just about half of our samples. And the highest concentration that we detected over this year was of acetaminophen, the active ingredient in Tylenol, which was at nearly 4,000 nanograms per liter. And again, I want to remind you, this is a site that does not receive wastewater treatment effluent. But these kind of summaries that I just gave can kind of gloss over some of the temporal variation in these samples. So here we're looking at the time series of all of our pharmaceuticals. And what I hope you can see here is that there are several compounds, several classes that we detect only a few times over the course of this year. And what that suggests is that if we have only gone out, if we had only gone out a couple of times, we would be missing kind of the full scope of the different mixtures of compounds that can occur in this stream. And another thing, if you kind of, if I gave you 5 minutes to study this really intensely, that you might see is that these are not occurring, these compounds are not occurring together. They're not like co-occurring in mixtures where we have some days with high detections of high concentrations of everything, and then some places where there's nothing. They're sort of each winking in and out of our detection almost independently of one another. And what is difficult to see in this particular visualization of the data, but you can see better here, is that there's not really any strong relationship between concentration and the stream flow. So we have days that we detect nothing kind of across the whole range of stream flow conditions. And we have relatively high total concentrations detected across this range of stream flow conditions. So breaking up our kind of main question, the first part of it is asking about the annual load of pharmaceuticals in this stream. That we have kind of two main categories of difficulties with calculating that load. And I'll break these down in a second, but sort of broadly speaking, our approach is going to be to examine potential extremes in watershed behavior and sort of bracket or envelope what we think the load might be by taking a couple of different assumptions and calculating the load given those assumptions. So first, we have several observations that are below our limit of quantification. And if we were calculating loads for macronutrients such as nitrogen and phosphorus, the way we would normally deal with this would be to set those concentrations at half of our methodological detection limit. But because pharmaceuticals, unlike these macronutrients, just might not be in the system at all. With macronutrients, we can assume that they're there and just below our ability to quantify, whereas with pharmaceuticals, it's possible that they're just not in the system at all. So we can take both of those approaches and for any samples below the LOQ, and we can combine that with some different assumptions for interpolating the concentration for those stream flow observations between our weekly samples. So to get that kind of full time series of concentration, the first approach we took is to assume that there's absolutely no temporal autocorrelation in our samples. And for each discharge observation, just pull from the observed population of concentrations randomly and assign that concentration to any given discharge. The second way that we can assume the concentrations between our weekly samples is to simply do a linear interpolation of the observed concentration. So these are kind of two extremes of assumptions about how those unobserved concentrations behave. And so what this gives us is four different estimates of the annual load once we take those discharge time series with the filled in pharmaceutical concentrations and sum them up over the year. And so here's the outcome of that work. So here we see four different symbols for each of these categories of pharmaceuticals. And for the most part, you can see that they fall between about 0 and about 2 kilograms per year, with the kind of striking exception of the analgesics, which are up around 15 kilograms per year flowing through this this urban stream. And if you're like me, kilograms of pharmaceuticals don't really have any meaning to you. So just to put that into context, we're talking about the equivalent of about 30,000 tablets of Tylenol moving through this stream, somewhere between 740 and 2,400 doses of antibiotics, and somewhere on the order of 9,000 to 51,000 kind of adult human doses of antidepressants. And so often when we're talking about pharmaceuticals in the environment, we talk about concentrations because those are kind of the benchmarks that matter for the aquatic life in that system. So why am I presenting these loads? Well, looking upstream, quantifying this in a load, in a mass per time, lets us help partition that load and identify the sources or pathways by which pharmaceuticals can enter streams. Like we talked about wastewater treatment plant effluent, but also leaking sewage or sewage overflows can be important sources. And looking downstream, knowing this annual load is one important part of estimating the ecological risk for receiving waters. So now we have some estimate of the total amount of these contaminants that are entering the Chesapeake Bay in any given year. And that can help us understand whether they're going to build up in that environment or not. So now we'll take this load and we'll use some publicly available data to start partitioning this load into the different potential sources. So first, we'll start off with just one compound, looking at trimethoprim, which was the pharmaceutical that we detected most frequently. And so here, we used an approach of calculating what we assume the load to be in the sewage produced by the entire population of the watershed. So that is, we took the concentrations that are reported in wastewater treatment plant, multiplied that by the average per capita sewage volume produced in a day, and scaled that to year, and then multiplied that by the entire population of this watershed. And from that, we could back calculate the amount that we assume people use, and we just verified that with some kind of citywide pharmaceutical sales numbers, and we came pretty close with that verification. So here what we can see looking at this together is that altogether humans use about 24 kilograms of trimethoprim in any given year in this watershed, and the majority of that is routed to sewage because our bodies do not very efficiently metabolize this. Then we used SSOs. So Baltimore, it has separate sanitary sewers. So we don't have the combined sewer overflows, but there are blockages that cause sanitary sewer overflows. We multiplied the volume of reported SSOs by the concentration in wastewater treatment plant effluent to get an estimate of the mass that is lost to sewage leaks. And those occur within the study watershed. And then we assumed that the remainder was routed across that watershed boundary. I feel like you're gonna tell me 3 minutes, Sarah.
I am gonna tell you three minutes, that's so funny.
Cool. great. So yeah, the remainder of that was routed across the watershed boundary to the wastewater treatment plant, where again, very little of it is retained. So similar to our body's ability to metabolize, the retention in wastewater treatment plants is pretty similar. So most of that is routed to effluent, some of which is diverted to industry. And then the amount that's in leaking sewage and the amount from effluent are combined to go into the inner harbor. Now we can compare the mass balance of this pharmaceutical to that of acetaminophen using the same methods. And what I'll point out here is that the amount that humans use is about three orders of magnitude greater. But because our bodies metabolize it much more efficiently and because it's much more efficiently retained in wastewater treatment plants, we end up with a really similar total mass that goes to the harbor. And beyond that, because of this efficient removal in wastewater treatment plants, it turns out that the sewage leaks are a more important source of this to surface waters ultimately than wastewater treatment plant effluent. So what this suggests is if we're doing the majority of our studies of the environmental impacts of pharmaceuticals near places with wastewater treatment plant effluent, we might be studying a mix of pharmaceuticals that's not representative of these other places that we know pharmaceuticals occur. So
1 minute.
My takeaway is lease and aging infrastructure contribute pharmaceuticals, and the relative pathways can differ for different pharmaceuticals. With that, I am finished.